I will now call upon Maulana Sahib for his presentation. At the end of his presentation, we will accept questions from our online viewers. To submit your questions, please visit the website www.menti.com, and the code that you will need to enter is 661921. This code, inshallah, will appear on your screens in a few minutes. But again, it's go to menti.com and enter the code 661921 to submit your questions online. With that, can I please request you to welcome Maulana Sahib for his presentation.
أعوذ بالله من الشيطان اللعين الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام على سيد الأنبياء وخاتم المرسلين سيدنا ونبينا بالقاسم محمد اللهم صل على محمد وعلى محمد وعلى أهل بيته الطيبين الطاهر المعصومين واللانة الدائمة الباقية لأعدائهم من الآن إلى قيام يوم الدين أما بعد فقال الله سبحانه وتعالى في كتابه الكريم إنما حرم عليكم الميتة والدم ولحم الخنزير وما أحل به لغير الله فمن اضطر غير باغ ولا عاد فلا إثم عليه إن الله غفور رحيم Dear sisters and brothers in Iman, السلام عليكم ورحمة الله From the Islamic perspective, when we look at the present life, this dunya is known as darul bala, and the hereafter is known as darul jaza. When we say darul bala, means in this world we will be put to test and trial, and in the hereafter, darul jaza, we shall be recompensed for our beliefs and deeds. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in Surah Baqarah, Surah number 2, ayat 155, says very clearly that each one of you will be put to a variety of tests and trials. People sometimes will be put to challenges, situations like fear and insecurity in the society, hunger and thirst, loss of wealth, loss of life and health, loss of children and dear and near ones. So people will be tested and tried in different ways, but sometimes the test and trial could be widespread and cover the entire society. This does not happen always, but we hear in history about widespread, you know, famines, fires, earthquakes, and plagues of different kinds. Coronavirus or COVID-19 is such a bala and trial of our time. It has covered almost all parts of the world at the moment. Since early February, in my Friday khutbas, I have repeatedly emphasized the importance of following the advice of the health officials so that we can protect ourselves as well as others from this virus. When we are faced with a virus that can easily spread among the people who attend a large gathering, many rules of the Sharia change. For example, we know in Islam that congregational form of daily prayers, jamat prayers, is greatly emphasized in Islam. But if this gathering is going to increase the risk of spreading coronavirus, then the recommendation, the istihbab, loses its emphasis. That is why you see that we have suspended prayer gatherings here, as well as many mosques around the world, including in Mecca, in Karbala, and Iran. And this includes the Friday prayers, which cannot be done individually. Similarly, all other religious gatherings that we have, celebrating the birth anniversary of the Masumeen, the commemoration of the Shahadat of our Imams, and special events, which are quite a few in the month of Rajab and Sha'ban, the gatherings of this kind also lose its istihbab, its recommendation, in face of the high risk of the spread of the virus. We should at least be thankful to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for the technology that we still have, where we can listen to the sermons live or recorded, related to special events online while sitting at homes with our families. So continue with your prayers and du'as at home. Another example where the recommendations are suspended are the a'mal, special rituals that we do in Rajab in a collective form. And especially when you look at even Umrah, the minor pilgrimage in Rajab, Sha'ban, and Ramadan, this Umrah also loses its istihbab and emphasis because of the risk of getting infected and infecting others. God forbid if this spread of COVID-19 continues till Shawwal or Dhulqa'd, then even the obligation of Hajj this year will be suspended. Finally, from the religious point of view, I would like to emphasize that those who know that they have been infected with coronavirus, they are not allowed religiously to attend a gathering where they can spread the virus to others. If a person knowingly does so and spreads the virus to others, then he or she will be religiously liable for her harming others. Emergency situations demand drastic decisions. Let me give you an example from the Quran. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in Surah Baqarah, Surah number 2, ayat number 173, gives us the main list of the meat that is forbidden. إِنَّمَا حَرَّمَ عَلَيْكُمُ الْمَيْتَ وَالدَّمَى وَلَحْمَ الْخِنْزِيرِ وَمَا أُهِلَّ بِهِ لِغَيْرِ اللَّهِ. Whatever dies by itself, not by slaughtering, whatever die, the blood is haram. Similarly, the flesh of pig is haram. And also the animal over which a name other than that of Allah has been recited while slaughtering. All these become haram. But then the question comes up, if you are stuck in a death or life situation, then what do you do? And this is where we see, if there is no food at all, you are stuck at top of a mountain, for example, which is only filled with snow and nothing else. There is no shrubs. There is no food there. What do you do then? You have only haram meat. Are you allowed to eat that haram meat or not? Do you eat the haram meat to save your life, or do you die with hunger? This is where we see that this verse of Quran that I recited earlier continues. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, فَمَنِ اسْتُرَّ غَيْرَ بَاغٍ وَلَا عَادٍ فَلَا إِثْمَ عَلَيْهِ إِنَّ اللَّهَ غَفُورٌ رَحِيمٌ. But the one who is compelled to eat the forbidden food in case of emergency without being desirous of it or exceeding the limit, then there is no sin on that person. Verily Allah is forgiving and merciful. This is an example where the rules temporarily change because of emergency situations. Let me end with a very important, you know, challenge that we have potentially. And that is to do with the primary rules of Sharia, which is about the funeral rites of a death caused by COVID-19. This is the first potential challenge that comes to mind. I received an inquiry on February 12th from a Shia in Wuhan, China about it. I was also approached for advice in case of the death of an elderly Shia lady in Seattle in early March, who had passed away because of coronavirus. And so this is something we have to really discuss, because the normal obligation of ghusl mayyit, hunut, and kafan can be modified or totally suspended based on the instructions of the health officials. What I would like to mention now is just very basic guidelines, not going into details, that what can happen if a person, you know, from the community, passes away because of coronavirus. Number one, if the health officials allow the washing of the body, then those involved in the ghusl of the body and the kafan process must wear full personal protection equipment, which is known as PPE. Moreover, the PPE should be worn and disposed according to the guidelines of the health department. And the ghusl room must be disinfected totally after each usage. The second scenario would be that the health officials say that you are not allowed to open the body bag because of high risk to those who would be handling it. In that case, the requirement of the three ghusls given to the mayyit and the hunut would be veiled and suspended totally. And instead, tayammum can be done over the body bag once, although it is recommended to do that three times in place of three ghusls. And then the body bag can be wrapped in the outer piece of kafan, which is known as chadar. And once that is done, then the namaz-e-janaza, salatul-janaza, and the burial would be done normally. In order to protect others and avoid large gathering, only family members and relatives should attend the janaza and burial ceremonies. And the rest of the community should remember the deceased in their du'as and prayers and convey the condolences to the family via phone or email. These are some very general guidelines so that, I presented here, so that the members of our community should be mentally prepared for it and cooperate with the directives of the funeral committees of your respective centers. The World Federation and NASIMCO, under the guidance of health officials and religious scholars, including the office of Ayatollah Sistani in Najaf, is coming up with details for the funeral committees to prepare them accordingly. These temporary changes in rules of funeral have understandably distressed some people. But remember that tayammum is also a valid substitute of ghusl. So tayammum is also an ablution, but it is a substitute for the normal one. And if that is also not possible, then the suspension of the requirement of ghusl or tayammum or kafan is also within the parameters of the Sharia laws because of extraordinary circumstances. Moreover, it's important to keep in mind that when the rights of a mayyit collide with the rights of the living person, then the rights of the living person will prevail over the rights of the mayyit. And in this case, we are talking about the volunteers who go and help in this situation of ghusl and kafan and hunut. Some people look at this issue from an emotional point of view, and they say, how can we bury someone dear and near one to us without the ghusl and kafan? I would just say, think about it hypothetically. If it was possible for you to communicate with the deceased, and you would ask that deceased, who is very clear and is related to you, dear and near one who has passed away, ask if you were able to ask that marhum or marhuma, that do you still want the normal ghusl and kafan to be done at the expense of exposing the deadly virus for those who are going to be handling the body? Or would you prefer the method of tayammum or just the minimum requirement of namaz and burial? If the dead body can talk, I'm sure the answer would be that you who are alive should protect yourself. So my dear sisters and brothers in Iman, continue doing the prayers and istighfar during these days and months. Seek the wasila of Muhammad and Ali Muhammad in your du'as so that Almighty Allah can make this world and the humanity free from this virus. Let me end with this du'a from Imam Zainul Abidin alayhi salatu wasalam. Allahumma awjidni halawat al-afiyah وعزقني برد السلامة واجعل مخرجي عن علتي إلى عفوك ومتحولي عن سرعتي إلى تجاوزك وخلاصي من كربي إلى روحك وسلامتي من هذه الشدة إلى فرجك Wallah, let us find the sweetness of well-being. Let us test the coolness of safety. Appoint for us a way out from our illness by your pardon. Change our infirmity by your forbearance. Transfer our distress by your refreshment. And safety from this hardship by relief from you. إنك المتفضل بالإحسان والمتطول بالامتنان الوهاب الكريم ذو الجلال والإكرام والسلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته.
Thank you, Maulana Sahib, for that presentation. These are extraordinary circumstances indeed. For the next 30 minutes, we would like to invite questions for Maulana Sahib. Please restrict the questions to the subject at hand relating to the burial rites under the present circumstances or present conditions. We have been receiving questions over the last few minutes. Some of them do not relate to the subject, and so we're filtering them out in the interest of time and suggesting that Maulana Sahib can answer some of the questions that relate directly to the topic of his presentation. So I'm going to read out some of the questions that have been coming in over the last few minutes, and we'll request Maulana Sahib for a response. The first question that seems to be quite popular is, are these signs of the appearance of the Imam of our time?
Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. It is difficult to say that. I will just say that, you know, when you study history, you hear about similar situations, you know, in form of waba, plagues, which took place in the past, where we hear even among the Muslims and even Shia centers around the world, especially in the Middle East, where you hear that half of the city was wiped out because of that pandemic or the plague. And so I would not, you know, jump into that and say that this is the signs of the end of the time or the zuhur of the Imam Ajjalallahu Ta'ala Faraj Sharif. We just have to look at the challenges which that this pandemic has brought and fulfill our duties in the best possible manner. And that is how we should be also, of course, you know, refocusing on the purpose of life and the priorities that we should have in our life, and always be ready for the appearance of the Imam Ajjalallahu Ta'ala Faraj Sharif.
Thank you. The other question that we've received is, how did the prophets or imams handle a pandemic in regards to the economic circumstances relating to the pandemic? Can charity be used to help the sick? And were state taxes like khums used as well to help the sick?
As far as the example during the days of the prophet or the imams are concerned, At the moment, I cannot recall any such example, other than that there is a famous statement where the question was that if a plague of a or pandemic, you know, happens in your city, what do you do? The issue was that you should try to get away from it and not to go to that city. So the issue of even keeping distance to avoid the spread of the virus or the disease was an important message. As far as helping those who are in need at that situation, from the medical point of view, you know, providing relief for them or even providing basic needs, food and water and things like that, definitely this will be an important or top on the, of the list when we talk about charity under these circumstances. So there is no doubt about it that this will be classified as a very important step in charity and sadaqah. And as far as the issue of using khums is concerned, if we don't have enough funds in form of donations and sadaqah, indeed that also will be an acceptable way of using it, of course, depending on the permission, which I think will come very easily from the marja of the time.
Thank you. The next question relates to if we're not able to get back together as a congregation until the month of Ramadan as a community, and we don't know whether or not this will be the case. We're still assessing the situation as the days progress. But the question that has come in is, how can we increase our spirituality at this time if we cannot be together during these blessed nights?
I think when we talk about not only Ramadan, but the remaining days of Rajab and Sha'ban and Ramadan also, of course, these 3 months happen to be the spiritual season, as I call it. Maybe this will be an opportunity for us to look at our, you know, energizing ourselves spiritually from a different angle. We have been fortunate to have communal gatherings where we do things together, and that indeed, you know, boosts our morale on a spiritual level, gives us also the opportunity to learn things where that we can do during the special, you know, days and nights of these holy months. But sometimes when we talk about spiritual building, isolation is an important part of it. For example, we see itikaf is highly recommended for the month of Rajab, Sha'ban, and Ramadan. And what is itikaf? Itikaf means you go in isolation. You leave your family, you go into a masjid, and stay there at least for 3 days. Itikaf must be done for at least 3 days. And you fast at that time, and you basically spend your time in prayers, contemplation, in reading, so that you can increase your spirituality and awareness about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So this element of going into isolation to further our spirituality is an important element. And I would say, you know, look at this tragedy or this, you know, extraordinary challenge that which has come. Look at a positive side of it now, that we have been forced to go into isolation. Instead of doing things as a community, we'll be doing as a family or as individuals. And probably you will be able to see the benefit of even doing things on your own as far as spiritual building is concerned, inshallah.
The next question on the subject is, should we be performing Salatul Ayat? What type of adhkar and a'mal do you recommend?
Namaz ayat, salatul ayat, is not a salat which is to be recited in the kinds of waba or plague and things like that. It is more to do with natural disasters as such. So namaz ayat would not apply. What we should be doing besides doing the besides the wajibat, we can increase our nawafil prayers, our du'as, especially when we talk about du'a tawassul, when we talk about the or the namaz Hazrat Ja'far Tayyar, even Ziyarat Ashura, and even focusing du'a nutba. And these are the things which should be probably done even more during this time, so that may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you know, help us, the entire humanity, during this difficult time, and get rid of this virus from all human beings, inshallah.
If the public health system mandates cremation, does the rule of exception in emergency situations apply?
I think when we talk about the issue of burial and cremation, we realize that burial is also a pretty good way of, basically preventing the virus from spreading. They could even put, I've seen the example in Qom, that after putting the body in the ground and putting over the slab or the, here we have the coffin, they also put some chemicals on that before they put the earth on the coffin or the body. And so I don't think it's a matter of, you know, cremation is better or more forceful or better way of dealing with eliminating the spread of virus. I think burial is good enough.
The question, however, was that what if the public health authorities mandate cremation?
We'll have to probably try to get exception for our ritual of burial.
Okay, thank you.
If we can, yeah.
What is the best way of practicing social distancing and not cause hurt feelings of others who are not practicing social distancing, and to remind them of this religious obligation under the present circumstances?
I think under these circumstances, it's important to remind them, but be polite and remind them that this is not just a issue of good behavior. This is actually a religious obligation to maintain the social distance so that we do not end up, spreading the virus. Because if it is done knowingly, as I said in my presentation, a person becomes liable for it in the eyes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So the main thing is to remind the person, but do it in a polite manner without, you know, humiliating that person.
Thank you. If death occurs naturally during these times, will the burial be normal or modified? Or will the funeral rites be performed normally, or will they be modified? If you could just maybe repeat that one more time.
If the person dies because of normal causes, not because of the coronavirus, then the rituals would be same. The ghusl and hunut and kafan would be done normally. It's a secondary issue that, you know, the people involved in the ghusl and kafan should take precaution during this time in order to use the entire, you know, protection gear for themselves, just in case. But then the other rituals will be done normally.
Can reciting Ziyarat-e-Ashura help in this situation?
Definitely reciting Ziyarat-e-Ashura, especially dedicating its sawab to the mother of the Imam of the time, Ajalallahu Ta'ala Farij Sharif, and then doing tawassul to the Imam, that, you know, we recited the ziyarat on behalf of your mother, dedicated the sawab to her, and so that you will be able to gain, inshallah, the tawassul of Bibi Fatima Zahra, as well as Imam Zaman Ajalallahu Ta'ala Farij Sharif, inshallah.
What if it is unknown as to the cause of death for an individual, what kind of protection should be taken in that circumstance?
I think in as far as we know, the system, the way it works here, the cause is known, and if the mayyit is not known to be, have, you know, passed away because of COVID-19, then I think we will go through the same normal process of the funeral rites. However, those who will be involved in the ghusl kafan, they should take the full protection there.
What if PPE, or personal protective equipment, is not readily available because of shortage? What then is the obligation on those who are performing the funeral rites if PPE is not readily available?
I think that's where we come to the issue of, you know, to what extent they can protect themselves. If there is a reasonable way of doing it without having the entire, you know, protection equipment, If they can, that can be done, that's what should be done. Otherwise, we cannot put the living people who are doing the ghusl and kafan at risk in that situation. And so we'll just move on to the option of doing tayammum on the body bag.
Can the beard of a man be altered in order for a male doctor or nurse to wear a respirator N95 mask, either if they're on the front line or during burial? The N95 mask requires a precise fit on the face, and therefore some medical professionals suggest that depending on the size of your beard, if you don't have a snug fit on the with the usage of the mask, then your beard may have to be removed in order to be able to wear the mask. So in that circumstance, can a man, shave off his beard so that he can wear that mask?
Definitely, when it comes to extraordinary situations, you know, the rules will change, and especially those who are on the front line. If that is a must in order to protect that individual, then shaving of the beard would be permissible.
They say that the nadr of Imam alayhi salam can help cure anything. Should people still attend these kinds of occasions, nadr at people's houses, with the belief that it will cure you and keep you safe?
Well, just to clarify for some other viewers who might not understand what nadr means here in this case, we are talking about the food specially prepared in order to serve the mu'minin and mu'minat in the name of Imam Ja'far al-Sadiq alayhi salam, for example, during the month of Rajab, or in the name of other imams. Well, you don't necessarily have to go to somebody else's home to eat nazar. You can do nazar at your own home yourself and eat the nazar.
There's a hadith of the Prophet that says that if someone dies of a plague, they die as a martyr, and some people are relating this to the coronavirus. Is this true?
I haven't seen a hadith of that kind. Of course, there are some hadith which says, for example, about the Shia, you know, ala man mata ala hubbi ali Muhammadin mata shahida, for example, whoever dies with that love for the Ahlul Bayt, for Ali Muhammad, and his death is like the death of a shaheed and a martyr. Whether that also, there are many hadiths of this kind with different wordings. I can't recall which talks about somebody dying in a plague or a waba situation. So I can't really make a comment on that.
Can this virus be seen as a sign of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's disappointment with the acts of humanity?
It is difficult to make that judgment, whether this is a punishment from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he is angry with us. Inshallah, this is a very broad question. So in one of the video talks, very soon we'll be tackling this subject by itself, inshallah.
What du'as are recommended to be recited during these times for protection of yourself, loved ones, and humanity?
I would recommend the last du'a in the list of du'as from Sayyife Sajjadiyya of Imam Zainul Abidin alayhi salatu wasalam.
What is your opinion on those who are against closing their centers and saying that these are places of shifa and they should therefore remain open?
I think they should look at the example of the custodians of the haram of Imam Hussein alayhi salam and Hazrat Abbas. Hussein's Zari, the dome of Imam Hussein alayhi salam, that area around the Zari, this is, you know, tahtul qubba. This is one of the places where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has granted the shifa. But because of this risk of spreading the virus, the custodians, who are religious people, and scholars, they have decided very wisely and religiously to close the place down. And so if the haram of Imam Hussein alayhi salam, which is all itself a confirmed place of Shafa, is being closed, I think the centers in North America are not that more sacred.
Is it wajib or mandatory to use the cold room for the mayyat, meaning that you store the mayyat, if there's a possibility that you can then give ghusl to it later on, as opposed to tayammum?
This was a question which was also sent by the Islamic Education Board of the World Federation, part of the questions they had on this issue to Ayatollah Sistani. And basically, it all depends on what is the expert opinion on this issue. Is really keeping a body for 2 or 3 days going to eliminate the spreading of the virus in the body and eliminate the virus? So then we can delay the issue of ghusl and kafan. If the experts are sure about it, then maybe that would be one way of handling this issue. But remember that this is something kind of a new form of this corona. And so even the medical experts, I'm not sure, would be able to give a very definitive answer on this issue, whether the virus dies after the body has become cold.
If we provide the hospital authorities with a kafan, in the case of a death that's occurred as a result of COVID-19, and they are able to put the kafan on the body before they put it into the body bag, would you recommend this?
I would say that if the health personnel at the hospital can do that, then even our volunteers can do that with the same kind of protection, inshallah. So we would prefer that it's done in the proper way then.
How do you do ghusl of a mayyat without catching the virus if they have died of the virus and have germs on their body?
Well, that's one of the issues we discussed. If the virus is there and the risk of spreading to those who are going to handle the body is there, then we actually are suspending the issue of ghusl there.
If a person dies of COVID, will he or she be considered as shaheed?
Not in the sense when we use the word shaheed and the implications of shahadat. For example, when we talk about Ansar of Imam Hussain alayhi salam, or those who were killed in Karbala, or those who were actually killed because of their iman and faith. When we use the term shaheed for them, that is a designation given to them, and it comes with implications like ghusl wouldn't be required. They can be buried in their own clothes. They don't need a kafan either. But that is for somebody who is killed in the cause of his or her faith. And so even if we use the term shaheed in a very general sense, it wouldn't really have much of an impact in how we would handle the body.
If a deceased person was in quarantine and the family members are also quarantined, can the burial be delayed for a certain period of time so that the family members can participate then in the burial of their loved one?
It's again a call of judgment. It depends for how long the delay is going to be there and what are the implications. Is it going to increase the risk of spreading the virus from the body to others or not? So all these things have to be considered before a decision can be made. So it's not a simple yes and no answer for this.
Is there any merit to the Islamic medicine theories that have been mentioned in some videos, for example, here in the Quran? If yes, why haven't they been mentioned much? And if not, why are they being promoted by some and confusing people?
Well, I haven't really seen anything credible about it, and I would say that when it comes to the social media, not everything that you see there is always that authentic. We have to be very, very careful and not, you know, just accept whatever we see in the social media at the face value. No, you have to see who is the source, who is speaking, where do they get this information from? Because if you look at the instructions of our religious scholars, the Maraji, Ayatollah Sistani, Ayatollah Khamenei, all across the board, without any exception, everyone is saying, the very first thing they are saying, listen to the instructions of the health officials. And so that is the first thing that we are being told. Now, is there is a cure there? Nobody has yet been able to come up with that.
How does one perform tayammum on a mayyat when it is inside a body bag?
Well, the normal process of tayammum on the body would be if it's not possible to use the hands of the mayyit, itself, then the person administrating the tayammum would basically, on the body bag, they would basically, after hitting their palms on the earth, they will go to the same area where there is the face and basically wipe the forehead of the mayyit from a covering or the body bag, and then they will do that again, and then they will go and wipe the right arm, and then the right hand, and then the left hand. And again, they will strike their palm on the earth and wipe the hands again. So that is how it's going to be done from over the cover.
Can you please clarify what Syed Sistani's office is preparing with respect to funerals under the present circumstances and how they should be conducted?
We don't have any specific instructions about it, but the main thing we have to keep in mind, the overall guidance that we are getting, for example, large gatherings which will be an opportunity for the risk increasing for spreading of the virus should be avoided. So keeping that in mind, for example, we would say Namaz Janaza should be limited to family members or relatives only, and not a large crowd, not the whole normal community joining. Similarly, when we talk about the issue of burial, we should avoid opening the coffin at that time.
Is it okay to use hand sanitizers with 60% or greater alcohol levels?
The alcohol used in hand sanitizer is not najis, so there's no problem there.
If COVID-19 continues into the spring and summer months, the healthy may be impacted, food shortages may occur. How does this affect or impact the month of Ramadan and the act of fasting?
Well, there is no special rulings about it. You will have to look at the health situation of an individual, whether under those circumstances, whether the person would be able to, do the fasting without seriously harming his or her health, then they will continue normally as far as fast is concerned. So there is no special ruling of fasting in this situation. You will have to look at it at the time and see whether you are able to cope with it normally without putting yourself at greater risk.
For the mayyat, is ghusl-e-irtimasi a possible alternative instead of tartib?
I think ghusl irtimasi, I'm not sure whether in ghusl mayyit there is an option or not. I'll have to double check that. But even if the option is there, I think doing it ghusl irtimasi will create more chances of spreading the virus than doing it tartibi.
When a person is lowered into the qabr, should it be open or should the casket be open or closed due to COVID-19?
Normally, the coffin is closed anyway, so even in this case, it will be closed, yes.
If we have to handle a dead body at its final time and we have to perform the act of closing the eyes or, you know, straightening the legs and hands, does that become sakit at that time if that body is infected?
Surely those issues are there, but in this situation, because of the risk involved, all these requirements or istihbab recommended things would be suspended.
What about at the cemetery? Are we still reciting talqeen and shaking the shoulders of the deceased person if the person is infected?
Under this situation, first of all, talqeen is not wajib, it is recommended. And under these circumstances, the talqeen would just be recited over the closed coffin.
If the deceased had requested to be buried in their hometown, that is overseas, and presumably the deceased was infected, what type of procedure is to be followed? Presumably, they're asking, can the body be transported or repatriated back to their hometown for burial?
I don't know what are the legal implications these days, whether even the countries would allow a body to be sent to their country if it isn't because of the death happened because of coronavirus. So I think first of all, you will have to see whether legally it's possible or not. And if it's possible, there are other issues which should also be taken into consideration. The risk of spreading the virus, number one. And then the issue that when the body is transferred from one country to another, embalming takes place where they take out the entire body from blood from the body. That itself is a process which is open to risk for those who will be administrating that this procedure. And so I think it's not going to be an easy decision, legally or religiously, to make at that time.
I noticed that we're almost at the time, so we'll just take two last questions, and then inshallah we'll wrap up the session. In the case of a COVID-related death, what is the absolute minimum in terms of burial rites that one should perform?
I think the absolute minimum is to make sure that Salatul Janaza is done and the burial is done.
Okay. And the last question, Sayyidina, is if a Muslim passes away due to COVID-19, would it be permissible to use the body for a postmortem study if requested by the government health body?
The preference in our fiqh always is that if there are other bodies available for that research, then we will prefer that the Muslim body be given a decent burial.
Thank you, Sayyidina. I know there have been a number of questions that have come in that we have not had a chance to answer. Some of them have been answered already, and there have been repeats. If you have any further questions, please feel free to contact the office, the ISIJ office, and inshallah we will request Sayyid to answer those questions. But this program comes to a close. We hope the session was informative, and we thank all of you for tuning in. Mu'mineen, please take all the necessary precautions that the medical authorities have recommended to stay safe and healthy. Stay in touch with friends and loved ones. Provide assistance and support as needed, but more importantly, remember one another in your du'as. May he hasten the appearance or the Imam of our time. Ajjalallahu ta'ala farajahu sharif. Ameen. Wassalamu alaikum jami'an wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.